Warning, this video will make you deliciously data literate. Your discretion is advised. Hey cutie, Damsel in Data here, typically in the business of talking about data science careers, but today we're gonna do a bit of a switcheroony and talk about one of the ways that data scientists use their knowledge every single day outside of their jobs. Why? Well, because this particular slice of a data scientist's brain is actually crucial for every single person on this planet to have and use. And sadly, most people do not. It's tragic. And I know this is harsh, but we are not in the business of sugarcoating things here because you are already sweet enough. But what's even sweeter is that this very video will equip you with the statistics superpowers that you need in order to see right through misinformation, just like a data scientist does. You don't need any prior statistics knowledge, and if you're already a statistics pro, what a great way to review what you learned in the classroom and make sure you're actually applying it in real life. Make your teachers happy. We're going to start off the video by talking about the very first thing that you need to remember anytime you're consuming information. And then we're going to go into why statistics exists and how
every single one of us relies on her every single day of our lives and she never gets the appreciation that she deserves.
And finally, we're going to get into the meat and potatoes of the video where we talk about how statistics can be properly used in order to create factual information out of data, to draw conclusions about this big old crazy world that we all live in. And with this, we'll be defining some very important terms that you need to know in order to be a certified sweetie of statistics. So now, without further ado, let's get literate.
Data literate.
Jumping right in, we have the number one thing that you need to remember anytime you're consuming information that may or may not be true. Always ask for the receipts.
Oh, did you want a receipt?
Yeah, I do. Every single time. Especially when I'm at the data shop, which is just life. Okay. What does this mean? Never believe a fact without checking the source of the information first. This includes, but is not limited to, things you hear, see, or read on social media. These little quick form videos, infographics, and sound bites usually don't do a great job at sharing the source of the information that they're communicating. So it's crucial for you to know how to verify it before you blindly believe or, God forbid, repost it. Usually the source we're looking for here is a research report published by a verified institution, preferably one that isn't trying to sell you anything. So for example, you read on your favorite social media channel about how applying topical collagen to your skin on a daily basis will help keep you young forever. To your delight, there is a source attached to it. Yay, this is awesome. But then to your dismay, you read the source and you realize that it's published by a company that produces collagen-based skincare products. Ugh, yikes. Doesn't look great. It doesn't mean it's automatically false. It just means that you need to do a little bit more digging to see how they arrived at that conclusion before you believe it, because they do have an incentive to have you believe it. I'm making that money, honey. All you have to do is just take a swing at researching it yourself to see what kind of things you find about that topic, because we live in the age of Sir Google and Madam Wikipedia democratizing information for us all. How lovely. The important thing is just to not believe by default, because 70% of what you hear on a daily basis is actually false. That was a test. Did you pass? I know you passed. I know you passed. Because guess what? I just made that statistic up completely, pulled it out of nowhere. And you would know that if you took the simple step of asking me for a source, because surprise, I do not have one. So now that we got that out of the way, let's talk about the gift that the math gods gave us, Miss Statistics. Some questions in life can be answered with absolute certainty. Are you watching this video from Mars right now? No, maybe someday my videos will make it to Mars. A girl can dream. Did it take me, Damsel in Data, not one, not two, not three, but 4 road test attempts before I could successfully obtain a driver's license? Yeah, sadly, that is a fact. One that could be easily verified by asking me, or even better, checking the record held by the city. Other questions in life cannot be answered with absolute certainty. And for the most part, this is because there is far too much data required to do so, and that data either doesn't exist, or it's too difficult and/or expensive to retrieve. For example, if we wanted to answer the question of, does being a fabulous data scientist make you a horrendous driver. We would have to
survey every single person who drives, record their occupation, figure out some sort of metric to determine how good of a driver they are, and apply that universally across every person that we survey, and then actually do the work of crunching these massive numbers to discover whether or not data scientists should be the bench warmers of the road.
Nobody would ever do that. The data scientists who can't drive are safe for now. You're welcome, fam. I got you. But fear not, all hope is not lost to discover the truth. Enter statistics, a tool that allows us to answer this question and many, many, many others with a reasonable amount of uncertainty. Sorry, I should say an acceptable amount of uncertainty to get to an answer that is good enough for our standards. Properly applying statistics is the next best thing to being certain when being certain is not an option. So much of what we think we know for certain today is actually just statistics telling us that it's our best bet to believe it's true. Most medical treatments that we apply, major societal research topics like climate change, most of what we understand about science and the natural world around us, these are all just statistics in disguise. There's actually a whole lot that we do not know for certain, and statistics helps us fill in those knowledge gaps to the best of our ability using the data that we have available to us today. Grammy for most underrated artist of the millennium goes to statistics. Woo! Yeah! That was weird. I won't do that again. Applying statistics to answer a question or test a hypothesis really just means using sample data points to infer the behavior of a population. Quick nerd term check here. A population is the complete group of people or animals or molecules or whatever subjects we're trying to draw a conclusion about. A sample is a subset of data points taken from that population that we will use in our experiment or study to see if we can learn something about the broader population. Nice. That was good. Two important things to remember about the sample. Very simple. It has to be big enough, and it has to be round enough. And by round enough, I mean well-rounded. Representative of the entire population. Sounded better in my head. Anyways, we have to be fairly confident that our sample represents our population fairly well, covering all the bases. For example, if I found 5 data scientists who also happen to be bad drivers, would I be able to conclude that data scientists tend to be bad drivers? Well, if I did, I would encourage you to call my bluff because that is not statistics. Data scientists are humans, as far as I understand, and humans are complex creatures, which cannot be in any way represented well by a measly 5 data points. There are countless other factors that could have caused these particular 5 data scientists to be bad drivers. These are called confounding factors. Remember that term for later because we will be circling back to it. Using 5 data points to represent a population of hundreds of thousands has zero validity. But how big of a sample size do we need to properly conduct a study about a population? To demonstrate this, let's move away from my silly data scientists on wheels example and move into a very practical application of experimental design, drug testing. Not like taking urine tests to see if someone has taken drugs. That's not what I'm talking about. Clinical trials, when you're trying to test how effective a drug is on a certain population. Drug testing would also use statistics, by the way. Almost everything does. In a clinical trial, the population would be everybody in the world or in a part of the world within a certain age group that has a certain condition or exposure. So we have to define this first, depending on who our drug is for. And then once we have our population defined, we would pull sample data points from that population. The sample data points would go into one of at least 2 groups, the control group or the treatment group. The participants in the control group will not take the drug, and the participants in the treatment group will take the drug. And with that, we can compare the effects of not taking or taking the drug. This is where I want to circle back to an important term, confounding factors. In the context of a study, confounding factors are differences between the control group and the treatment group that can get in the way of observing the impact of the treatment. Rude. Ideally, we want the only difference between the control group and the treatment group to be the treatment itself. The very purpose of a control group is to control for other variables so that we can observe the impact of the treatment that we're trying to study without anything else getting in the way of that. For example, if our medication at hand is a heart medication, and we had participants in the control group engaging in more hours of cardiovascular exercise than participants in the treatment group, this could obviously have an effect on the observed impact from taking versus not taking the drug. Number of hours spent doing cardiovascular exercise would be a confounding factor. We don't want this to be different between the two groups. Of course, it will never be 100% possible to get participants in the control and treatment group to behave in exactly the same way, except for the treatment, but a good study will eliminate confounding factors as much as possible. This is why in clinical trials, we have the control group typically take a placebo drug, so a sugar pill or some version of the drug that doesn't actually do anything. And the participants in both groups are typically not privy to which group they're in. So they don't even know if they're getting the treatment or not. Because even knowledge of the fact that you're getting the treatment or not getting the treatment could be a confounding factor that could impact the results. All right, so now that we know about the components of a proper study, let's talk about interpreting the results of that study. Let's make up some data here. Out of 1,000 participants in our trial, we had 500 in the control group, 500 in the treatment group. Of the 500 in the control group, let's say that we saw 275 of them with improved symptoms throughout the duration of the trial without any medical assistance. They didn't take the drug. And in the treatment group, we saw 300 of them with improved symptoms throughout the duration of the trial with taking the drug. So at first glance, it seems like, woohoo, our drug worked. Slow your roll here, because it's actually not that simple. We need to determine if this difference in results that we're observing is actually because of the treatment or if it's due to chance. Remember, there will always be some level of variability in the data and the humans behind the data and the circumstances going on throughout the trial. So the difference that we see here could actually be due to chance, like it surely was with our example of 5 bad driver data scientists. Now, that one was more obvious because it was only 5 sample data points, but it is possible to have fluke results even in a very well-defined study with a larger sample size. Determining whether or not a study can be trusted is referred to as testing for statistical significance. Meaning, can we say with reasonable certainty that the results that we observed in this sample are well representative of the expected results that we would see in the entire population? Was our study good enough to draw a conclusion? To answer this question, we would apply a statistical test of significance. What this entails is essentially plugging our data into a formula that will spit out a number, and the value of that number will tell us if we can say with reasonable confidence that the results of our study are strong enough to not be due to chance. Studying an event in a statistically significant way is referred to as hypothesis testing. Every such test, aka study or experiment, begins with a null hypothesis, denoted as H with a little O or 0 subscript, and it's pronounced H naught or H null, and don't you dare try to pronounce it as anything other than that. The null hypothesis is a statement that we believe to be true by default, and the purpose of our study is to see if we can gather sufficient evidence against it. In our example, the null hypothesis could be that taking the drug has no improvement on symptoms when compared to not taking the drug over a given period of time, aka the drug is whack. The alternative hypothesis, denoted as H with a little A in the subscript, and I give you permission to pronounce that as ha. In our case, the alternative hypothesis would be that taking the drug has an improved effect on symptoms. Once we plug our data into the appropriate statistical test of significance, in this case, it would likely be something called a Z-test. The number that the test would spit out is a value referred to as a p-value, and the size of our p-value will tell us whether or not our results are statistically significant. In other words, whether we should reject the null hypothesis because our study has found sufficient evidence against it. So if this does turn out to be the case in our example, the results are statistically significant, that means that we can say with reasonable confidence that taking the drug has an approved effect on symptoms for the entire population of people that would take this drug when compared to not taking the drug. But what happens if our p-value tells us that the results are not statistically significant? Well, this really just means that our study is inconclusive. We could be experiencing something called sampling error, which means the data in our study wasn't big enough and or round enough, so there wasn't enough of it, or it wasn't well representative of the entire population. Or it could just be that the drug really is whack, and all of the data and studies in the world wouldn't ever be able to prove that it isn't. We will never know. And that, my friends, this
mystery and allure
is the true beauty of statistics. She's lovely. She really is. But my goodness, do you see how much effort it takes before we can draw conclusions from observing data? It's bananas how many steps we have to take before we can claim that something is the way it is. Keep this in mind next time you catch yourself believing something immediately by default. And you'll need it when that one friend inevitably comes up to you and tells you about the latest health trend that's so good for you. To sum up, when you're presented with information and you do not see a source, that is not information to you until you validate it. If you do see a source and that source doesn't mention or explain use of any of the terms that we defined today, the results are not to be trusted, much like I am when I say I'll make another video soon. A proper study will always mention the population and the effect that we're trying to measure. It will always be clear about sample size and sampling technique. A proper study will always mention confounding factors and how they were accounted for, and most importantly, whether or not the results were found to be statistically significant. If the information you're consuming does not contain any of the nerd terms that we went through today, you can assume its authors are imposters of the dark arts of statistics, and you should dare not trust them. All right, that was my best go at summarizing first-year university statistics, for the most part, within the time frame of today's average attention span, which is longer than the one I have, for the record. This was a very simplified version of Statistics 101 to get you going and to set a baseline of understanding, but really, I could make a whole separate video about any one of these topics that I talked about today. There's really so much to discover in the world of statistics and data and how to use it in real life, and there's just so little time. So if you enjoyed this kind of video and you want to see more of it, or you want me to expand on any of the things I talked about, please let me know in the comments. I hope you enjoyed today's class. Your homework is to like, subscribe, and share this video if you liked it. I will catch you in the comments, and otherwise, have a data literacious day. Class dismissed. Thanks for watching. Bye.